Farmers, and we're here for a session called Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas Pavilion, and is sponsored by the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, or we call it IECA. And what we're going to talk about today is energy. The session will outline producer and value chain partner perspectives on what is needed to scale bioenergy and nature-based solutions in support of a successful attainment of ambitious national and global greenhouse gas emission reduction goals. One of the things that we really want to get into is farmers produce an awful lot more than just food, although food security is the biggest thing that we are known for. But we also produce clean water, clean air, other things that of value that we call them ecosystem services. And primarily, it's important to know that we're mainly all, majority of us are all family farmers. But we also, it's very important to be involved with biodiversity. The more we can produce with the different things, the better off we are. We have a distinguished panel today, and I'll start by giving a short introduction of each one, and then we'll get into the program. First of all, we have Brian Sievers. He's from Iowa in the USA. He's a grain and livestock producer. He's co-chair of the Iowa Smart Agriculture and vice chair of the American Biogas Council. Next to him is Doug Bourbon. He's from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and he's vice president for corporate affairs at Polk, the largest producer of bioethanol in the United States. Next to him is Evandro Busi, the president and CEO of the Brazilian Sugarcane Industry Association, or they call it UNICA. And last, but not least, the best for last, is Verity Uluvari from Ava Farms in New Mexico, USA, and she manages a diversified livestock cropping system on her farm. So let's begin by you, Brian. Why don't you, I'll give you a few minutes to tell us what you're interested in and what you do at your farm.
Thank you very much, Fred. I've got just a short four or five slides I will bring up. You can go ahead and advance. So our farming operation located in eastern Iowa. Iowa, for those of you that aren't familiar, is in the centric part of the United States. We focus on capturing the beneficial aspects of recycling and processing of livestock manure from a beef cattle operation. We also process food waste and biomass for energy generation through our anaerobic digesters, and in so doing produce enough fertilizer for our not only our own farming operation but for neighboring farming operations as well. And we also focus on what can we do to enhance water quality in our locale, in our community, and then also really focus on the soil health benefits from the circular agricultural business model that we've implemented in our farming operation. Next slide, please. So this is our farm located in eastern Iowa, taken at a time of the year when there was lots and lots of CO2 work sequestration and carbon sequestration going on, as you can tell. We have a couple of beef cattle confinement buildings, 1,200 head each, so we have about 2,400 head on feed at any one time. And then we have an anaerobic digester, actually two anaerobic digester tanks located on that farm. This farm has been in our family for about 115 years. Our parents, I should say our great-great-grandparents settled in this part of Iowa in the late to mid, about 1851 to 1852 era. So our roots run pretty deep in Iowa, and we take a lot of pride in making sure that the natural resources we're blessed with, that's the air, land, water, sun, and people, are used to their highest and best use. Next slide, please. So this was actually a model kind of pulled together by a professor at Iowa State University, a professor by the name of Dr. Lisa Schulte Moore, and she really wanted to focus on the circularity of what we're doing in our farming operation. And I can kind of read you or walk you through, but basically we start with the crops. We have a diverse rotation of corn, soybeans, wheat, rye. We do a lot of double cropping now and planting of cover crops. We have a continuous, we try to focus on having continuous living crops of some sort, whether they be corn or soybeans or cover crops, on our land at all times of the year. That helps protect the soil from erosion. It allows us to retain the nutrients on the soil. The grain, of course, is either sold to generally a local processor, like an ethanol plant. We happen to have some ADM ethanol plants in our area. Or it's fed to the cattle in our feedlot. The crop residues we harvest from that corn are used as bedding in our cattle barns. And then any environmentally sensitive land that we might have, maybe along a creek or a stream or a body of water, we're now planting perennial grass and forbs too, to help protect that air and water quality. And eventually we're going to be harvesting that perennial prairie as a feedstock for our digesters as well. All of the digestate that comes out of the digesters is used as a fertilizer source for the crops. So that's the circularity we're focusing on in our operation. One portion of our farming operations waste is another feedstock for the next part of that farming operation. You can tell livestock, of course, beef production, it's the main source of income on our farm. The manure that is produced from those cattle is used in our digesters, and it also helps us reduce the odor and the greenhouse gas emissions, of course, from the methane that we capture in the manure in our digesters, and use that then for an energy source. At the bottom left of the screen where we talk about the biogas, currently we're using the biogas to produce electricity, and we sell that to the grid. But eventually, by the middle of 2023, we're going to take the biogas, upgrade that to renewable natural gas, inject that into a pipeline, and sell that as a liquid transportation fuel for the industry. Presumably, there will be a buyer in California for that gas, and then will allow us to participate in California's low carbon fuel standard. And then finally, under the biodigester, again, if you're not familiar with the digester, basically envision two large stomachs, about 970,000 gallons each, and you're digesting organic waste streams, whether they be from the manure, it might be from food waste. We actually have food waste from all the major species, poultry, swine, beef, and no horse. There's no processing of horses in the United States, but certainly beef, swine, and poultry, we process their waste streams in our digester. A lot of the processing of some of the other organic waste we bring in from the food industry that's located in our area, we will probably have to build another digester to manage those separately, primarily because of the EPA and some of the regulations that are being currently in place with regard to how the renewable natural gas that's produced and the value through the renewable fuel standard that it's given and the RINs that are earned. So we try to accommodate not only the regulatory framework, but also the practicality of digesting various waste streams. So by building a separate digester, we'll be able to continue to process food waste, industrial food waste, but in a separate digester tank. So next slide, please. That's it, and my slides. And I really want to just try to make that as my introductory comments. We really want to focus, at least here in our panel, I think, and certainly in our farming operation, that common theme of what are the solutions that we're trying to provide to decarbonizing agriculture production actions. This is what we're doing on our farm. How can we enable farmers to implement these types of things? We've actually been having that conversation this afternoon. There are a variety of ways to do it, and again, this is what we can do on our farm in eastern Iowa. What's the economic opportunities? Well, this is a viable economic model. It's and therefore will help us encourage others to consider adopting anaerobic digestion as a part of their sustainable business model. And we also think by enhancing the sustainability of farming practices and improving the economic viability, it's also going to provide a better way for us to provide food security, not only for those of us in the United States, but for consumers around the world. And then finally, we think that the circularity of that model that you just looked at is really kind of the vision of the future, if you will, on trying to make sure that we maximize the value of all those resources we're blessed with, the air, land, water, sun, and people, in the highest and best use. So with that, Well, thank you very much. Now we'll turn it over to Doug.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Good morning to those of you watching online. It's a pleasure being here. My name is Doug Berman. I'm with a company called Poet. We have our face slide up here. Poet is the largest biofuel producer in the world. We produce about 3 billion gallons of bioethanol on an annual basis, about 15 billion pounds of distillers grains. I'll talk about that in a minute. We have 33 plants in 8 states and about 2,200 team members. We produce about 975 million pounds of corn oil each year. And we buy, Poet, the company, buys about 7% of the U.S. corn crop on an annual basis. So that's who we are. We are in our 35th year of operation. We're just celebrating our 35th birthday right now, actually, while we're here. So with that, I'm going to get into a little bit of our message. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the production process of an ethanol facility in the United States. And I'm not going to go through the process. What I want to show you, what I think is important to understand, are these yellow circles on the bottom. Obviously, we produce bioethanol. That is our main product. But when we take corn in the United States, we do not consume the corn. We transform the starch into ethanol. All the protein, all the fiber, all the oil goes right back into the markets that corn is grown for originally in the United States. And a little known trivia, less than 1% of the corn grown in the United States is actually for human consumption. 99% of all the corn grown in the United States is No. 2 yellow dent industrial corn, used for a number of different things. But as you can see, we are producing a number of different products right now. CO2. We are actually capturing CO2 at a number of our facilities, and we scrub that, clean it, and we sell it into the food industry. So the bubbles in your Coke or your Budweiser or something like that are probably CO2 from our facilities. Let's see. We need to go back one. That's okay. Bioethanol is obvious. COVID got us into the hand sanitizer business. Obviously, we're in the alcohol business, so it was just natural for us to clean up the alcohol that we're using in transport and use it in hand sanitizer. We've become a fairly large player in the sanitation area right now. So industrial products are another thing. Purified alcohol for industrial purposes. Jive there is a product we make out of our corn oil, and we sell that into the asphalt business. It makes asphalt more pliable and greener, believe it or not. We also use corn oil for biodiesel and renewable diesel. So imagine that, a biofuel company making biofuels as a byproduct of our production process, ethanol, biodiesel, renewable diesel. And hopefully we'll be buying some of your biogas in the not too distant future too. And then Dakota Gold on the right hand side, that is that's Distiller's Grain. That's our brand name for Distiller's Grain. That's a high protein food product that we make. Like I said before, about 7 million tons of that product go all around the world to feed every type of livestock, from cattle, swine, dairy, poultry, fish, you name it. In fact, we make, as an industry in the United States, the bioethanol industry produces enough distillers' grains to provide the daily protein content for 550 million people a year. That's how much protein we're producing out of the process. So we're not depleting the world of nutrition, we're enhancing the world with nutrition. I think that's a key point to understand. We always say that if we want to solve the climate problem, we have to start getting our resources from the surface of the land rather than the center of the earth. Okay? And it seems like a daunting task, because all we know is the oil era, right? But until 200 years ago, we got everything from the surface of the land. And we can get back to that in a very manageable and economical way by managing agriculture and unleashing the potential of agriculture. It's critical. I think you're going to hear that from just about everybody after. Next slide, please. So that's where we are today. I want to talk a little about where we're going. So this is a little bit different diagram of our circular economy. It starts with the corn or biomass, plant material over here, and it goes into a processing facility. We make a lot of different products out of that. We can use the biomass to power the facility of the brine facility. And then we can capture the CO2. Like I said, we're making food grade CO2 right now. But that's just partial CO2 capture from a few of our plants. We have now signed up to capture a lot of the CO2 from a number of different plants, which we'll put in a pipeline and we'll ship that to Illinois and we'll sequester it under the ground. Another really important thing to understand. In the springtime, the Midwest of the United States is the largest carbon sink on the planet. Because of all of the plant growth, corns and soybeans and wheat, and everything growing is soaking up all that CO2 from the atmosphere naturally. Now we take that into our facility and we can capture that CO2, put it in a pipeline and put it underground. Now we're not talking a circular economy. We're talking about breathing in CO2 and putting it into the ground. That is decarbonizing our atmosphere. And we can do that economically. So it doesn't put stress and strain on the way we live. That's really important to understand. So as we look at this, we'll have solid fuel boilers, we'll have anaerobic digestion, and then on the far-hand side over there, you can see what we're making: renewable diesel, biochemicals, biojet. We can use bioethanol in the diesel sector, believe it or not. We can use it in aviation. We can use it in marine. We're obviously using it in cars. In the United States, 10% of every gallon of gasoline you put in your tank is bioethanol. In Brazil, it's much higher. We can take a lesson from Brazil and increase our blend rates and clean up our air more, because the more bioethanol you have into the fuel supply, the less toxic chemicals you have coming out of the tailpipe. It's healthier for our air, our environment, it's healthier for human beings. It's just an all-around superior product, frankly. We need more of it. And I think the message that I make sure that we get out here is that the potential of agriculture is very misunderstood. The potential of agriculture in the United States is huge. We have a long way to go. Would you not agree, Ryan, Fred? The potential of agriculture around the world is virtually untapped. It really is. For generations, the United States has subsidized family farming. And when we subsidize family farming and send cheap grain around the world, it stifles global agricultural production, right? How can the world afford to farm if the United States can't afford to farm? Biofuels creates a market, a critical market for agricultural products to be able to have a margin. When there's a margin in agriculture, Brian and Fred and everybody can invest in infrastructure, innovation, technology to improve and to grow. If there's no margin, we can't do that, okay? So it's really critical we understand the potential of agriculture around the world. Next slide, please. I think this is our last slide. Next slide, please. There you go, okay. So what I really want people to understand is that the world needs agriculture. Agriculture needs biofuels. I often say on the bottom here, it says, biofuels are the catalyst to successful agriculture. Successful agriculture is key to solving the world's most pressing issues. Climate change, poverty, hunger, and disease. Is there another industry that can really reach out and solve problems like agriculture? Agriculture needs to be managed properly all around the world, and that's what biofuels helps us do. Creating a margin, creating successful agriculture. Agriculture is a way to solve a lot of problems, and we want to make sure that that's well understood in this section today.
Well, first of all, it's an honor for me, Freddy, to be with you and to listen and to learn precious lessons of sustainability and productivity. Brian, congratulations, nice to hear you. I can say the same and Doug, and my precious speech. I would like to try to resume one quote. We became a sustainable industry because nowadays we see the farm, since the farm as an industry in Brazil and of course in the United States, you are doing the same thing there are some decades. But more than a sustainable business, our opportunity now is to have the sustainability as a business. Not only the sustainable business, but the sustainability as a business. Because what you are selling here, it isn't only products, it isn't only energy, it isn't only food and feed. We are selling sustainability, reduction of CO2. In our experience in Brazil with bioethanol and now with biogas and biomethane also, it's interesting. It started in 1973 with oil crisis and pushed by government in that moment. We would like to substitute, replace gasoline for ethanol that we already use it, in Brazil since the starting of 19th century. Now we have one of the best experience is in the usage in the fleet. Because as you mentioned, Doug, all gasoline in Brazil has 27% of ethanol blend. And we don't have problems including the imported cars from United States, from Japan, from Europe. We have cars from every brand. I have an interesting story. Once talking with the Chinese ambassador in my home, he said, oh, but this problem with ethanol because the imported cars and blah, blah, blah. And I said, Mr. Ambassador, may I do a personal question for you? Oh, yes, you are in your home, you can. Which car do you use? I use a Land Rover. I asked it, mate, in the UK. Ambassador, I have good news for you. Your car uses 27% of ethanol. And he arrived the war 3 months only. He asked it for for his advisor. It's true. Yes, Ambassador, all gasoline in Brazil has 27% of blend. More than this, we developed a high technology in automotive industry is the flex fuel vehicles that you have also in the United States. The cars in Brazil are able to use between 0 and 100% of ethanol, and then all fuel station in Brazil has at least 2 pumps of gasoline with 27% of ethanol, and ethanol itself, 100% of ethanol. 80% of Brazilian light fleet, auto cycle fleet, is flex fuel one. And this, here are my key messages. First, we are part of the solution. The agriculture industry is the part of the solution, not the solution itself, because the solution itself doesn't exist, in my opinion. We will need, all the world is here to try to achieve something in deep challenges. But we will need all the clean sources of energy. We can't avoid anyone. Because this, we are part of the solution with bioethanol, with low carbon crops, with in food and feed and energy and fiber and every environment of the human existence involving some kind of energy. Because as you said very, very well, and I am excited to hear you, because for example, for sustainable aviation fuel, there isn't routes developed outside of biodiesel and bioethanol, bioenergy. We don't have a problem. I was with the VP of Total in France 4 weeks ago. They don't know. They don't know how to achieve the Corsia agreement in more 5 years. They have challenges in 5 years. And we have a wonderful route with ethanol, for example, and biodiesel. From that, our experience is a circular economy closet, because even in sugarcane or in corn, because Brazil is growing or increasing your corn ethanol production, we use vinasse from the process of ethanol, and vinasse and fuller cake, the result of sugar production. They pass through a biodigester, and we capture the biogas, and we purify in biomethane. And we are using that in our trucks, in our tractors, machines, and everything. Well, to finish, I would say Brazil and the United States have a deep mission to share this experience, because no one wants a new Russian gas. And ethanol, for example, is concentrated. 80% of global production is in the United States and Brazil. Less than 10% is in the global trade. Because these we are working hard in India, for example, not to sell ethanol for them in this moment, but to increase, to see the growth of their production, the Indian production. Because we are talking about energy, and energy can't be concentrated geographically in one place. This is, in my opinion, one of our highest challenges and mission. Thank you.
Hi everyone. I'm honored to be here on this panel today. I don't know that there's a lot I can add with all this expert knowledge that's coming through and everything, but I guess what I can add is tell you about my farm and how that fits in with what these gentlemen have been talking about, and how that creating these markets that allow the usage of a crop to be spread out to many different functions for the benefit of different sectors is very important. So my farm is located in New Mexico, which is in the southwestern United States, and it is a semi-arid climate. Very different, our farming practices are very different than from a farmer in Iowa or other areas of the world where they have a little bit more fertile soils and it rains a lot more. Average annual rainfall is around 18 inches, so I think they're a pretty good idea of the fact that we are limited in our types of options from a crop production standpoint. But in our area, we also have a lot of native grasses. And on our farm, about half of our acreage is native grasslands that are used for grazing livestock, in particular cattle. And the other half is for cropping systems, which we grow winter wheat, grain sorghum, and forages. And for us, we also have to keep in mind how we're using the land and working the land so that we can continue to improve our soil health to be able to put these crops out onto the market and market them not only for our livelihood but for the input into the value chain for our agricultural systems. And when I grew up on a farm, so I grew up seeing our practices, and it was very, there wasn't a lot of broader thinking on how we can expand our marketplace and different things that we can do. Growing up, most farmers around us was continuous wheat after wheat and background in cattle or stocker operations, which would mean bringing smaller animals in and growing them up so they could be put in a feed yard. And over time, we had a small ethanol plant come into our region. It was about 80 miles away from our farm. And I was about a teenager at the time. And that really made a difference on our family farm because my father started growing grain sorghum, which we talk a lot about corn. But grain sorghum is used in the bioethanol process as well. It's comparable to corn in a lot of ways. But it is something that we can grow in our area quite well that flourishes, whereas when we try to grow corn, yields aren't quite as good for us relative to input costs. So grain sorghum was a great option. And that ethanol plant coming in gave us a marketplace. And I don't think I would be sitting here today with this panel had that not happened. So it's an important thing to stress from a standpoint of our sustainability of our farmers is it's important to have a marketplace. And not only do you need that marketplace, but you also, as a producer, need to do what you can to help your land work for you so that you continue to have those streams of product to put into the value chain. About 10 years ago, my husband and I started our farm on our own. We continued with a lot of the similar practices that had gone on before. We did update to the cropping systems and crop rotations that were standard for the time and have been for a long while with the implementation of grain sorghum into the mix. But because we were so dry, the thought was always, you've got to have a fallow period to give your land a rest, to help conserve moisture so that you can turn around and use that in your crop for the next season. About 3 years ago, my husband and I started saying, you know what, this is getting tough. We see a lot of volatility in our weather patterns. We're not getting the consistent moisture that we have been used to getting. It's become more volatile. You may have more extreme weather events with a whole lot of rain, and then go for long periods of time when you're in drought. And in the southwestern United States, it's a very true fact. We've been going through drought for a long time. So we've got to change something. We converted to a minimum till or no-till operation in a lot of our fields, and also added what we would call cover crops. In our area of the world, just to clarify, a cover crop is defined different than what it might be for a producer from Iowa. A cover crop for us could be the residue from the prior crop that we took off, or we leave that residue on, we don't till it in, we let it sit there and help protect the land over the winter months and keep wind erosion down, and it also helps. And it also gives us an option to graze those stocks with our cattle operation. So we found ways to diversify our products and our income streams to get the highest amount of productivity and profitability off of ground fallow for a season, we're putting a cover crop in, which might be a forage, and in times where it does rain and we can make forage crop and hay that we can use for our own cattle or to sell into the local markets, which would be local other cow-calf operators that are in need of hay that weren't able to grow any because they don't have crop ground, or we'll sell it to local feeder operations and dairy operations. But one thing that it also allows us to do is that we're not tilling the soil as much. We're not rolling over the ground with extra applications of herbicide or pesticide because those crops are helping us do that in an inactive way. When we put those crops in, it shades the ground and it keeps this hot sun from beating down on it and causing moisture evaporation or causing all of that heat to significantly decrease our soil health, and it kills the microorganisms in the soil. And at first it was very scary to leap out there and do that. You wonder, as a producer, am I going to be able to weather the storm? Am I going to produce something? But even just a few years into it, we're starting to see those benefits. And how that fits into this circular system of things, but we're out there doing this and our neighbors are thinking you're crazy, but all of a sudden we'll have a hay crop in the middle of a dry year that no one else had because we were able to conserve that moisture in the ground when they weren't. The year before, they just lost most of the moisture to evaporation. And so that allows us to have another way to generate income. We have hay and no one else does. And we're close to local dairy markets, so we can sell that hay that they would have to go hundreds of miles to get when we're right there. We'll also market our grains through the local elevator system or feed mills that can be processed into livestock feed, pet food. Some of it's used in human consumption, but we also run some of our grain through the ethanol plants when that's economically feasible, and I think that the support that we have in our, not just our local agricultural systems, but our regional systems, we all need each other to survive. We all may be a little different in how we come about it, but it gives us a strength and it fills those voids that you wouldn't have otherwise. If there wasn't a market for us to put grain sorghum in the bioethanol space at some point in our region, that may have never took off. So we may have never really seen the value of having a summer row crop, and we would have continued down this path of not adapting to the forces in front of us. So I'm happy to be here on this panel. I think we're at a really good point in telling the story. I think it's a good time for others outside of us, you know, we're singing to the choir, but to tell that story that it works. And it's okay to take that leap, but we also have to have some feeling of comfort that we can on a grander scale, because not everybody is that accepting of the risk. And we, in farmer world, we want to trust our peers, but we also want to verify that to where we're at in our locale. So I think panels such as this help us come together and build upon our experiences and learn from one another so that we can spread the word. So with that, I'll stop.
Well, thank you for all your comments. You all had interesting perspectives of looking at this, and as we can soon find out that there is not a one-size-fits-all in agriculture. There's lots of different practices, and I really think we do ourselves a disservice when we come to a conference like this and then try to define winners and losers. Every single farm, every single practice, every single system can be improved, and I think that's really what we're after here.
So what we've heard a lot about is farmers do a lot more than just produce feed and food. You know, there's all kinds of things that we do. We produce biodiversity and wildlife habitat. And the less tillage you have, and the more you don't touch your stubble or whatever, and leave your residue on top. I know on my farm, I've been no-tilling for 37 years, and I cannot believe the wildlife that we have now compared to what we had before. So the question I have for you, I'll start off with you, but if anybody else wants to answer, please do. So Brian, in my area, a lot of farmers are getting interested in soil health. We use a lot of cover crops. Some farmers are fine with accepting them, some farms are not. But we use precision agriculture, we use variable rate technology, all the things that, because farming is a business and it has to make the end game pay for itself. Do you have any ideas of how can producers to be rewarded? You got some ideas of what we should maybe have to, as possibilities that we can maybe benefit from monetarily for some of these things that we're doing?
Sure, I'd love to tackle that one. So let me just start off by saying when we developed, we've been operating our anaerobic digester since 2013, so 9 years of operation. The one thing that pays the bills are the electricity we were able to generate and sell to a power company. So our generator is a 1,000 kW genset. That's enough electricity to serve about maybe 800 to 1,000 homes annually, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That helped pay our bills. But when you start to look at what goes into a digester, lots of organic waste, manure and other types of organic waste, and then what comes out after what we call the hydraulic retention time, which is in our case about 40 days, what comes out is what really in my mind is the most valuable product. It isn't necessarily the biogas that we produce that can generate electricity or the biogas that we can upgrade to renewable natural gas and sell into a pipeline. It's the material that comes out, which is called digestate. The digestate is fully digested. It's a lot like compost. We separate the liquid and the solid fraction. The liquid we use as our fertilizer source in our farm, I think I alluded to that earlier. But the solids is a, we call it biofibers, but it's a compost-like material. And once we start applying that to our fields, we've noticed, and you talk about soil health, we've noticed in anywhere from 5 to 7 years, a rather dramatic increase in organic matter content. So organic matter contents, let me just back up 150 years. I mentioned our family settled in the mid-1850 era in that area. The organic matter content of the prairie soils was between 8 and 10% organic matter. Over the next 150 years through agricultural production practices that were developed and advanced, refined, we managed to lose over half of that organic matter in the process. So those organic matter contents that were at 8 to 10% in the mid-1850s are now in that 3 to 4% range today. That's not sustainable. So when I started to say, what can we do to change that? Is there something we can do to change that? I suddenly found out after about a 5-year period that the waste that comes out of those digesters and goes back into our lands increases the organic matter content. Now that isn't any different than if you use manure from a livestock operation, doesn't matter what kind, you're actually putting organic matter back into that soil. And what we've seen in those soils that were 3.5 to 4% just 5 or 7 years ago are now in the low 5% range. That's a dramatic increase in organic matter content in 5 to 7 years. And we hope to be able to see that continue to go up. I don't know where they're gonna stop, and there may be a ceiling to that, but at least we can identify that we have stopped a downward spiral or trend in our organic matter contents that was not sustainable. So by increasing the organic matter, we've improved soil health. We've fortunately, I believe, managed to say we can now sustain additional generations of people on our land and in our society with the ability to produce the food, feed, fuel, and fiber. So that is the biggest reward that I've realized as a farmer, is the increased inorganic matter contents of our soil as a result of processing waste streams, whether it be livestock manure or industrial food waste, through an anaerobic digester.
You want to answer?
Yeah, if I could just add a little bit to that. As a processor, we are also motivated to help farmers improve or manage soil quality, their carbon intensity on the land. And so we have come up with a solution with our partners, Farmers Business Network, called Ingrenuity, where we pay farmers to improve their carbon intensity based on the average CI score of corn farming around the country. And through our pilot program, we did this, we had farmers volunteer around an ethanol plant. They would give us all of their input data, their yield data, acres, all of that came in, was monitored throughout a two-year process. The farmers that were improving or doing better in their carbon intensity than the national average were paid on a sliding scale of how much they were improving. So let's say the average score for corn farming carbon intensity score is a 26. We have farmers that ranged from 13 to over 40. Now those that were above 26 didn't get anything but the going price of their grain at the ethanol plant. Those that were doing a 13 CI score, twice as good as the national average, were getting an extra 75 cents a bushel for their grain. Now the impact that that has on all the farmers around, I'm sure you would like 75 cents more per bushel, but you're probably one of those 13 CI score farmers. But if you were one of the 40 score farmers, you would want to know how that guy got an extra 75, right? So we did this pilot project around one of our ethanol plants. Now we're rolling it out to all of our farmers at all of our plants that consist of about 50,000 farmers all throughout the Midwest. They'll all have an opportunity. The challenge that we have is we and our partners funded the first effort. We can't do that alone anymore. We need the end users. We need the McDonald's of the world or the Walmarts of the world to start understanding on-farm scoring and how it impacts their CI score, right? Because corn comes from a farm, that's scored. It comes through an ethanol plant, it's scored. It goes into feed, that goes to a chicken at Tyson, that's scored. That goes to chicken sandwiches all around the world, right? If we can figure out that supply chain and how to track that scoring from farm to consumer, it will dramatically affect what we do in agriculture. Everybody up here is improving farming. That's what we do. Farming is not the problem, it's a solution. But I will also say this, there is no perfect, right? This is humanity. There is no perfect. There are just different levels of better. And what I can tell you is from a transport sector, bioethanol is the highest level of better that we have today. It's economically viable, immediately available, and clean. Just a fact. Agriculture isn't perfect, but it's got real potential to get really, really good. Nothing will ever be perfect. Everything can be better.
Hard to follow that, but I'll try. I know I'm a farmer, but I'm also a consumer. And at some point, we've all got to be responsible for our own actions and how to work on being climate smart, whether it's climate smart agriculture or climate smart consumer. And to the point of your company can't continue to just fund out of the blue the incentive for farmers to do their climate smart practices, but it is open to the marketplace. And as a consumer, if we really want to help do our part to help climate change, it helps to support those efforts through that value chain, so that what you're doing with those products that you buy, with those added value of all of the things we are talking about today, a little bit more of that goes all the way back through to the farmer that produced at the very beginning. And that incentivizes them to continue doing that. It's a carrot rather than the stick type of approach. And we have to be very mindful of the fact that even though we've all got a lot of things to do, the number of farmers in the world is a very, very small percentage. And so we've got to all do our part to help future generations to continue to have even a desire to want to do that. I'm a fifth generation farmer myself, but I had to go and start my own farm and come up with that capital to do it, and it is very hard. And it's a business, it's an economic thing that we want to strive for. I'm a numbers person. I have another career in agricultural finance. And so I'm very much paying attention to the profitability and long-term sustainability of it. But not just from a numbers standpoint, I want my future generations to have the opportunity to provide food and fiber and feed and fuel to the world. But we've all got to come together in this and realize how important we all are to each other. I can't be financially viable or climate smart if I don't have a consumer on the other end that finds value in my product. And so we've got to see the value through the chain of things and understand how important that is, because we're all working towards better, and we can all help each other. But if we're not kind of continually thinking of that circularity of where it begins, where it ends, and starting all over again, we're not gonna get any further.
I was also going to mention, and I know Poet also participates or will be participating in the USDA's Climate Smart Commodities Grant Program, and I certainly want to applaud the United States Department of Agriculture and their efforts to provide incentives to really do a significant amount of additional research on farm research, in most cases, for the kinds of programs, practices that will enhance the circular approach to farming and agriculture production. Our new partner with our anaerobic digesters, a company called Raceline Alternative Energy, they submitted a grant application under this Climate Smart Commodities Grant Program, and they were awarded a grant as well, and we actually on our farm, Seamers Family Farms, will be a partner in not only the grant, but also in the ownership of the digester facility. And so the $80 million grant that was awarded, our mission will be now to find out what level of incentive will be necessary for many more producers to do things like planting cover crops, or maybe consider planting perennial prairie on a marginal piece of land, and then use that prairie or the winter hardy cover crops as a feedstock for an anaerobic digester. Where's that price point going to be for not only the digester owner and operator at what they can afford to pay for that feedstock, but what's the price point to incentivize the producer who's not currently growing cover crops to do so in the future? And so that'll be our challenge and our goal with this grant, is to determine where are those two price points and how can we come together and meet in the middle, much like buying a car. You've got a seller and a buyer, and that's essentially we're trying to monetize and value the credits that we're generating through the carbon we're sequestering. That's the biggest challenge we're faced with today. Right now, carbon credit valuation and monetization is a wild west. We know that the USDA is taking a huge step forward with this particular Climate Smart Commodities Grant Program. We also think that they're going to be playing a role in providing a regulatory framework for the valuation, the accreditation, certification of carbon credits that we can produce, whether it be on Verity's farm in New Mexico or our farm in Iowa or Fred's farm in Ohio. We have to have that level playing field and set of rules, if you will, so we can equally participate in a carbon credit program going forward. I think that the carbon credit sphere, if you will, is going to be very, very large if we have a level playing field with regard to the rules, certification, and implementation of that type of program. So I see the USDA is playing a major role going forward in helping to provide solutions for climate change challenges and enhancing sustainability in agriculture production.
One experience that we have in Brazil is to measure and to transform it in money by carbon credits. The Renova Bill, it's the national policy for biofuels, we had an inspiration in California, but in my opinion, we got better because we analyzed each meal, in the case, for example, of ethanol or biomethane, biogas, and we know the specific carbon intensity of each plant, 22 grams per megajoule or something like this. And each 1 ton that we avoid in the atmosphere, the producer is able, the producer of biofuel, is able to emit one ton of carbon credit. This is, we have a negotiation in stock exchange system. Some million tons of CO2 were traded. And more than this, no borders for example, other countries. You must know that there are a lot of companies in the United States searching the certification for the Brazilian program because you are able to emit the C-bios, the credits, the carbon credits, and to sell in Brazilian market if you have the certification according to this process. And this is one thing, to develop this kind of market for carbon credits and carbon avoided. The second point is to put on the table some simple things. For example, we must to separate the trend and the technological road for the because the trend is reduction in mobility, for example. The trend is the reduction of CO2 emissions. Electrification, for example, is one of the routes, and for a lot of cases, it will be the best, but in other cases, it isn't the good. If the source of electricity, for example, is bad, is fossil-based, you don't have achievement of reduction of CO2. If you electrify the fleet in India, for example, with 84% of energetic matrix based in fossil sources, it worse than gasoline, for example, in carbon intensity. Then in Brazil, for example, if you electrify, if you expand something like $300 billion to restart, to reset the infrastructure. If you pay, as Biden mentioned, $7,000 per vehicle in terms of subsidy and EV for EVs. If you have everything, the carbon intensity is worst in Brazil because we have a wonderful energetic matrix. More than 80% of electricity is clean. You have the same carbon intensity of a vehicle using 100% of ethanol. And then, why do we expend all this money to arrive in the same problem? We will expend money to solve a problem that we don't have. That we don't have. Okay? And United States is another country where we see the real possibility of to increase because this dream of electrification, we will have a space for electrification, There are a lot of slots for that. No issue, because our ethanol, for example, I don't want to talk a lot, but ethanol means 6.5% of market share in comparison with gasoline. It's nothing. If we need to replace, for example, 15%, we need to have at least the double of the industry. If you need to achieve the aviation challenges, everything, we have a lot of opportunities, but we have to measure, to make money with this, and to put the speech in the right pathway, in my opinion.
You know, one of the things that I like to talk about is, we talk a lot about climate smart agriculture, and we're a member of the Global Alliance of Climate Smart Agriculture, and actually I'm the chair of the North American Climate Smart Ag Alliance. And we talk about the three pillars of climate smart agriculture, and I think it's really important to remember what they do, because they're really important. Pillar one is basically an intensification, sustainable intensification, I lost the word there. And that really means is that we got to continue to produce more with less, and farmers have to be paid a profit for them to do it. The last thing that a farmer wants to hear is if he's going to be regulated or taxed with something that's going to make him lose money. But sustainable intensification means that there's opportunities out there, and farmers can be very, very pliable and willing to try something new. And that's really important to think about. I mean, we talk about biodigestion, we talk about, you know, producing ethanol, we talk about even cover crops that you talked about that is actually can fuel a digester. I think that's a big potential boon for getting more cover crops planted. The second pillar is adaptation and resilience. You know, what we're talking about, that's why soil health is so important, because you mentioned that the soil health coming on your farm. But just remember, for every 1% of organic matter that you can increase in your soil, that's at least 25,000 gallons of water that it can hold, and that's for dry years. But even for wet years, when you have a deluge of water, it works both in wet years and in dry years. So it's really important that the soil health is important. But the other thing, too, is you know, we in Ohio have probably more water than what we need at times, and then times it gets dry. But we have a problem with the nutrient runoff. And so if you show a farmer that you can save, you know, up to $100 an acre just by securing the nutrients that don't run off, that's $100 that he doesn't have to pay to replace it. So it's really important that we recognize the economics of climate smart agriculture. Farmers will do it. And of course, the third pillar is reducing greenhouse gas emissions. And that can mean soil sequestration, like you said. You know, at one point in the spring, that's the biggest solar panel there ever was. I mean, with all of the crops growing. But also, farmers, when they do some conservation methods, there's less trips over the field. That means your carbon footprint is getting less and less as well. And so, we've also heard lots of stories about how you can reduce even your chemistry putting on farms for your weed control. You can actually eliminate some trips over the field because you have a natural way to eliminate some winter animals and things like that. So all three of those pillars mean that farmers can make money at it. We can actually be a very big solution to climate change, and we can be part of the whole world solution. And that means that's going to work all over the world. One thing that Solutions from the Land always has focused on is many, many tools in the toolbox. I mean, my farm is different than what yours is, Verity, and it's even different than yours, and it's certainly different than in South America. But yet, we all have the same ability to match up practices for what our farm is telling us to do. And that's what's really important. So let's have all the tools in the toolbox we possibly can so that we can pull that that tool out that's going to make us more climate smart before. So one question I have next is what would encourage farmers to experiment more? Because I'm convinced that we don't even know what's available or what's possible out there. How do we construct an opportunity for farmers to experiment and try something that maybe not as mainstream today, but it might be mainstream tomorrow? You know, I look at, you know, in my farm, you know, 30 years ago, we mobile plowed everything. We turned everything under, and today, you know, I've been no-tilling for many years, and now we introduced cover crops about 10 years ago. So I farm completely different. So what's the next big thing that we're going to maybe see? Does anybody have any ideas?
I'll start. I think it was mentioned with the USDA grants that are going to be coming down the pipe for a lot of these pilot opportunities to do that. I know that the National Sorghum Producers was awarded a grant as well, and they are going to focus on finding those things, whether it be certain practices that they will incent a farmer for, such as a no-till practice or a limited irrigation type of practice or certain combinations of those things. Even expanding into your adding some wildlife habitats and those types of things along with cover crops, to be able to get farmers' foot in the door, get their toe wet, dip it in there and see how that works, while also providing a level of cushion there to get over that hump. Because in a lot of these applications, as I've experienced personally, is you could have a lag at first. It's one of those things that you might have to take a bit of a step back for a huge leap forward, and a lot of times, you've got hesitancy to do that, especially in the farming sector where margins are razor thin and it's extreme volatility. So I think things like that are going to start yielding some of these solutions that we can work toward to begin to apply to various geographic areas. That even if it's a region like mine or even the sorghum belt in the USA, there are regions around the world that are similar. So this type of pilot programs can be used, or that information, the data that's gathered, can be used elsewhere in the world than just in the U.S. And I think that would be a huge benefit.
I'll just add to that a little bit. She said, you know, taking a step back to take a giant leap forward. I think that's a little bit of a mindset change, and I think there needs to be a mindset change with lots of different groups. One may be the farm sector. For generations, everything on the farm, and you guys are farmers, I'm not, so I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. But farming has been based on yield increases. That's what the mindset is. We want more money, we have to have more yield. Right? But what we're trying to do with our program now is say that yield is important. But if you take a small hit in yield because you're doing cover crops or no-till or whatever that small step behind, we're going to pay you with carbon, with carbon, on carbon. And so the mindset change for a farmer is, well, maybe I can take a little hit, but if I do, I'm still making the same or more money because I get paid on this carbon side as well. That's a big shift. But I have every confidence in farmers because farmers are innovators. You give farmers a problem and you pay them for it, they will solve your problem. That's one thing I know. We've seen that everywhere, all the time, for generations. We have always struggled with how in the world are we going to feed a growing planet, a growing population. Let me tell you, there is no fear of being able to feed a growing planet. There is none. Farmers need more markets, not less markets. Another shift, mind shift change, another group, is folks that believe that cheap grain means to cheap food and everybody eats. That's not the case. means farmers can't make a margin and they go out of business and we have less. Okay? We need markets for these products. And if we have markets for these products and the market grows, we will produce more and more and more. All while we are managing and improving agriculture. That's what's so exciting. That's why I keep talking about the potential of agriculture around the world. If, just for example, if the top 10 corn producing countries in the world caught up to where the United States is in yield, we would nearly double the production of corn. That's just 10 countries. Nearly double it. And that can be done. The soil in the United States is not twice as good as the soil everywhere else. It's just that they have not been incentivized like we have in the United States to improve and produce. We can do it all, but we have to change some mindsets.
Yes, I totally agree. And about the mindset, and sometimes ago we were thinking about, plus ethanol, less selling for United States or Brazil. But now, when we resume, for example, ethanol or biogas or biomethane in hydrogen, because this is the new word, hydrogen. Because you can imagine, of course, electric engine is more efficient, physically. More efficient than ICE. But you can imagine an electric vehicle, an electric engine, in which you don't need to have the electricity overboard, but the production of electricity on board with a fuel cell, with a reformer. And the reformer may be in the car, into the car, or in the fuel station, for example. Then you fill the tank of fuel station with ethanol, but otherwise to put ethanol in the tank, the reformer will capture the hydrogen and put hydrogen in the car. Tomorrow we will be in a panel, it's an invitation for you, in Brazilian Pavilion. And we are talking about that with Hytron, for example. It's a Brazilian company, and there are a lot of companies in the United States researching it. And Hytron has a system for a fuel station. They put the pump, capture hydrogen from ethanol, because it's easy to transport ethanol and very, very hard to transport hydrogen. And you capture and put in Mirai, the Toyota's hydrogen car. And if you can, then our challenge, I am convinced about that, our challenge isn't to fight for markets, but it's to have a supply for markets in 10 years. Because this, our experience, for example, in India, is a successful experience. They are increased the usage and production. And this next year, in January, with U.S. Grants Council, we will have 2,000 square meters in the auto expo, the auto show, the automotive exposition and convention in India. 1 million people per day, because it's India. Everything is a lot. Showing the benefits of bioenergy. This is my opinion to end with right public policies, to finish, because there is one sociologist in the United States that I love, Seymour Lipsett, and one of the most important books is The American Exceptionalism. In another part of the world, we need the public policies. In the United States, the market has a dynamic different of the world.
I not much more I can really add, other than I can probably expand on all three of those responses, because first of all, the things that we're going to learn from the USDA grants through the Climate Smart Commodities Grant Program, I think are going to move the needle forward. Secretary Vilsack calls it a renaissance for agriculture. agriculture in the United States and hopefully around the world. Fast forward 5 years, maybe even less, hydrogen, I also think, is going to be a tremendous potential. It's being developed right now. It's being used right now. Actually, I just flew over recently the largest hydrogen facility in the United States right here in Las Vegas. So that future is now. Obviously, making it to scale and commercialization of that technology is going to be our challenge going forward. But all of the things we do in agriculture will help us develop a hydrogen fuel cell future. And with what Doug talked about in the kinds of changes in technology that have occurred and what Fred talked about, you know, I just go back to, you know, again, my great-great-grandparents, when they settled here, that was only 150 years ago, not that long ago. Actually, it's 172 now. We're fast-forwarding our age, aren't we, Fred? But, you know, they started out farming without horses, and then it was horses, and then it became a plow, and then it became a mobile plow with a coat of, what was it, stainless to it, or shininess that John Deere developed. And allowed, it was a non-scouring plow. It allowed them to turn the soil over and do so with much fewer horses and much less horsepower. And of course, evolution continued, then it became a tractor pulling the plow. And then in my early years of farming in the 1980s, you know, we were still plowing, but shortly thereafter I started farming, we parked the mobile plow. It hasn't been used in 40 years. Nobody uses in the Midwest a mobile plow anymore, other than maybe a few farmers. Then it was a chisel plow. Now we've parked that or sold that. Then it was, you know, maybe we were just using a disc and a field cultivator. We don't use those anymore either. Now we use a little bit of vertical tillage if necessary. Maybe where we applied some of our liquid effluent and maybe had some ruts or erosion, we might do that in a spot in the field to help smooth the field and to prepare that seed bed. But the whole point of all of that, the technology that's been developed over the years by machinery manufacturers, whether they be large companies like John Deere or short line companies, was to help prepare a better seed bed. And now we're at a point where we don't need any of that tillage to prepare a seed bed that allows us to produce, you know, yields that far outpace what our great-great-grandparents produced many, many years ago. And, you know, that's the thing, is that technology has advanced to the point where we've now moved on to even higher level of technology with satellites that control our tractors. I walked out at the Farm Progress Show. It's a farm show held in both Iowa and Illinois every other year, and recently with my grandchildren. And we walked out into a field that was being harvested with a combine that had an operator, and then the tractor that pulled up with a grain cart right beside it did not have an operator. It was an autonomously driven tractor without an operator. Right across the alleyway were the drones that were being used to apply maybe a herbicide or a fungicide to a crop. Again, advances in technology in the last, even just 5 years, have been tremendous. So we'll continue to see that, I think, in agriculture, which moves the needle, which allows us even more efficiently to produce the food, feed, fuel, and fiber for a growing population, not only in the United States, but around the world.
One of the things that happened at a conference like this is everybody has an idea of what the answer is. But the one thing about a farmer is, if we talk, and Solutions from the Land talks to a lot of groups that some people would think, why are you talking to them? But there's always something you can agree on. So I think if we really focus on the outcome, the desired outcome, we may have a different ideal on how to get there, but if we focus on the outcome, we can come up with agreement. And this is a world problem. The planet is needing help, and we have to keep in mind that, you know, I think technology and innovation is going to be a real, really big part of our solutions. I think you've heard tonight that there's been a lot of ideas out here, and basically turn farmers loose and they'll figure it out. So that's really what we need to do, is have a system that allows for, maybe even have a safe harbor way to, you know, if we have a farm program that we won't be penalized too bad for trying something new, because I really do think that the best ideas are yet to be discovered. I was just wondering, is there any questions from the audience that would like to ask a question? Well, you want to go through and have one final statement from everyone here? Let's see what we're about out of time, but I do want to hear what you might want to say for the final thought.
Well, I want to thank Solutions from the Land, also this venue, this opportunity to really address how agriculture and farmers can positively impact climate solutions for challenges that we're faced around the world. So this is a great opportunity to continue to share knowledge, experiences, and help achieve solutions that we think all emanate from the land.
Yeah, I want to thank Ernie and Fred and the group and all of you as well. I guess my closing thought would be this. We can solve the climate problem without suffering through it. We can solve a large portion of the climate change issue by thriving through it. Just takes ingenuity, innovation, a margin. There has to be a margin, right? Without a margin, we don't have investment and innovation. And we've got to take the politics out of policy and just replace it with common sense reality. There's too much policy in everything, or too much politics in everything in life today. And I don't know where anybody on this panel sits in their ideology, it doesn't matter. We're all here for a common goal. And it can be done through very sensible policy and market mechanisms. We just need to put them in place and not be scared of what our future has in store for us. We can be excited for what our future has in store for us.
Well, first of all, it was an honor to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I think that we were concerned in these last years into build this wonderful environment that we built. The next step is to manage the stakeholders, showing some people that criticize us, showing what we are doing, and as you said, that you are the solution, not the issue. Thank you.
My takeaway from this discussion and really from this week is I'm optimistic. There's a lot of things in this world that we could be negative about and want to change and all, but at least we're here and we have a voice. It's important to not just preach to the choir, it's important to get our voice out there as not just farmers, but those in the entire system of it. It's the private industry, it's the public, that we all work together to help each other move forward. And it's very encouraging to see groups like this coming together, whereas, you know, before maybe we'd be competitors on another day. But competition is good. Competition makes us better. I don't know how many people did sports when they were younger, but you always wanted to go against the stronger teams or individuals that were better than you to help make you better. And I think that's what competition brings, as long as we're it's friendly competition and constructive, and we're all bringing each other up instead of tearing one down to rise to the top. So I think that would be my parting message, is to work together.
So part of the problems we have is probably a lack of being able to share knowledge like we should. You know, I'll just say this. I can remember 30 years ago, my first trip to Brazil. I saw an awful lot of no-till going on, and I was no-tilling my soybeans, but not my corn. And I saw your producers do all the way, and I actually came home. I was impressed, and I said, I want to do this. So if I wouldn't have had that chance to really see in action what was going on, that others could do it in the world. So we have to figure out a way to share knowledge in a better way, because knowledge is power, and we can all learn from each other. Farmers learn from other farmers, and so farmers, we need farmer leaders to come out and do this. So again, I would love to see in a conference like this, my good friend, and he's actually my co-chair, A.G. Caramaro, has a saying. He's always talking about, you know, we got lots of think tanks, but it's time we have a do tank. We got to do it. You know, it's time to do this. Instead of talking about it, we have to take care of it. And I want to thank the people that came tonight here, but I also thank the ones that joined online for this conference. So I appreciate your attendance, and I hope this was something meaningful to all of you. So thank you for being here, and we all hope you have a great time.